So welcome to my talk. I want to talk about how do you create your own openSUSE microOS today. Or what you're referring to is, in fact, systemd plus Linux, because we're going systemd all the way down. Let me introduce me first. I'm Jan. I'm mostly got online by JanVHS. You probably see me on GitHub sometimes. Like, I work for SUSE. I'm part of the Trento team and do their. I'm doing mostly full stack engineering over there. Outside of tech, I'm mainly a skater and musician, well, part-time skater to be fair, and I love course tech, meaning I do a lot of things which are not really mainstream, like sandboxing. I love bubble wrap, seccomp, eBPF, had written parts of a libc implementation with a friend of mine, and I am currently a lot of into immutable Linux distributions. You can find me online on those two sites, like my homepage and my Mastodon. And this is a picture of my current band, Mold Yard. We're a funk rock band, and it's very fun. Other than that, why build your distribution on top of MicroOS? Like, we have seen that in the talk yesterday. It's a really cool distribution. It's minimal, atomic, meaning you cannot really screw up your system that easily. And if you have ever installed NVIDIA drivers, you know what I'm talking about. It's simple compared to something like Silverblue. The immutability system of MicroOS is super, super easy to grasp and to understand. And it has a lot of nice packages because it uses the same code stream that Tumbleweed uses. But you don't just want to use the plain MicroOS. You want to have your own opinions and your own configs and packages on top of that and still make sure it's a nice, pristine system. So you're going to end up building your own MicroOS distribution. So what's it made of? Like, I would say we have three parts. We have the system components, meaning the Linux kernel, which is basically the brain of the operating system, like handling syscalls, for example. You have a file layer, which stores the files, I guess. And you have an init system. And this is basically responsible, like, for kickstarting the distribution and, like, making sure all the services run. Then you have packaging, which makes MicroOS a bit special because we use transactional update. There you can choose between MicroDNF and Zipper, but honestly, just go with Zipper. You have a lot of RPM packages and branding, which means an openSUSE configurations and, of course, like stuff like branding, like images and so on. Furthermore, we have OBS and Kiwi as our infrastructure. OBS is responsible for hosting our packages and building it, and Kiwi is, well, Kiwi is the builder. And I looked at this chart and went like, what could like I influence here? And it's basically, yeah, I can add my own packages. I can change configuration files. And I really want to replace Kiwi because Kiwi was hard to get into. So let's look at mkosi. mkosi is a systemd project. Well, it's under the systemd umbrella. And this means it's generally very well maintained and by the same people that make your init system. So that's cool. You can use it to build various artifacts like system extensions. And you don't have to know what those are, but just know you can produce a lot of things. And we're looking at raw disk images today, which is similar to an ISO, I would say. It's a cross-distribution project. It runs on every distribution. It can produce a lot of distributions. And if your distribution is not officially supported, you can just make a custom one, which is a bit limited, but it's fine. It's familiar, and it's like very easy to understand. So let's start with the first mkosi file. Up here, you see the file as a DOS ini syntax, which is very nice and easy to understand compared to a Kiwi XML file. So we start with a key saying what distribution we want to build. Basically, this just lets mkosi know where I pull to pull packages and like some specific quotes which are specific to openSUSE. Then we go on and describe our packages that we want to install. here we just install the minimum as possible, and of course, kose, because we want to have like our own packages in there, right? And the auto login is just responsible for not requiring you to set a password. Then we say we want a raw disk image, meaning it's just a file we want to have embedded in there is like the operating system and the partition table. And yeah, let's start it. We started with QEMU, as you would normally do. We got a failure telling us that it cannot boot it. Why could that be? Well, let's look at the configuration again and like inspect it with systemd dissect the image. So it's not bootable for UEFI, it said. And we have only one partition, right? We have a root partition there. It's BTRFS, which looks good at first, but if you think about it, you need a boot partition, right? So that's a limitation, but we can still run it in nspawn, which is systemd's tool for running container images. And here you can see that literally nothing is in here. We have no ls command because coreutils is not installed, but we have kose, and it works. Hey, so your next container image can be with the systemd. That's cool. Let's make it bootable. Literally, you only have to do two things. First, you say in the control section, hey, I want to install a bootloader. And systemd does it for you. Meaning you don't get the cool things that sdbootutil does for you on openSUSE. But, you know, it works. And the second one is you need to add, like, kernel, because how would you boot without a kernel? Bootloader and udev, which is like, responsible for doing a bunch of things. But, like, we don't get into that right now. And I took the opportunity to add our micro-OS patterns as well, because, hey, we want to create a micro-OS distribution, so let's do it. If we inspect that, we now see that it's bootable, and we have two partitions, meaning we have an ESP partition now, and we can boot it. So, yeah, I don't have a screenshot for that, but let's get on with our first pattern, because why would you create a distribution if you don't create your own packages, right? So let's start with creating a project. This is on build.openSUSE.org, which is our OBS build system. You need to sign up. I skipped that because it would take so long now. You can just follow the documentation online. It's easy to get started with. What's not so easy is like understanding all the concepts behind it. So let's first go to your home project, go to the subprojects tab, and create a new subproject, which is basically where your new distribution packages are going to live if they're not part of factory, like our main code stream. So let's go further. The hardest part, coming up with a name for your new operating system. I wasn't that creative for this talk, so we are going with Tokyo OS. After we created a subproject, we can check it out using the OSC command line. Super easy to install on most distributions. Fedora has it. Tumbleweed has it, of course. And even the AUR, the Arch User Repository, has a version of it. So let's check it out and create a new pattern file. This is a spec. It's just an except from it. We start at the top with some meta information about the package. I left some fields blank, but it's OK to work. And then you see the package base section. This is our first meta information about the package, about our first pattern. So you can see, okay, it's part of meta packages in the group, it's just only good for querying. And then we define that it is a pattern and give it pattern a name, make it visible. And now it's like the part where Richard Brown would, like the creator of Aeon, would disagree. I literally just require the micro-OS pattern, whereas he copies all of the contents over and maintains it himself. But hey, if you want to create a distribution and don't want to put so much time into it, just require the micro-OS base patterns, and then off you go. Furthermore, you need the bootloader we have been talking about because you want to install it, right? And then you need the kernel and, of course, our beloved kose. So let's go to the install section. The install is a bit weird, because somehow I think that's the reason somehow Zipper needs to know that your package is installed, right? So it owns some files. You see that at the bottom, basically, you just put a text file in a special directory so the package knows it's like installed, right? Okay. If you go on to building, you will see an error message. And at first I was like, what is going on here? I had no idea. Yeah, there are no repositories defined. I don't even know what that means. Well, turns out you need repositories. Repositories tell OSC where to get the sources. And in the GUI, it's like very easy. It's not like Git repositories. That's why what I first saw when I heard repositories, no, it's like really a description of where to get packages. And you get them from a distribution. And there are a lot of distributions supported by Open Build Service. I was very surprised. You have Debian, Fedora, even Arch, as far as I remember. But of course, we want to go with Tumbleweed now, because hey, it's the easiest for us now. And we're at an OpenSUSE conference. So after that's all done, we can commit our package, like create a change set, add it, and then build it. And if we build it, it works. You get a nice output of it. I haven't had a screenshot for it here, but you get a nice output telling you, hey, you have some warnings, but generally it worked. So let's add it to our configuration and to our image. First, you create a file, which you can see here on the bottom, into a directory called skeleton. It get mkosi skeleton. All of its content get copied over to the new image. And this is just a description for Zipper where to like find the packages. And after that, we only have one package left in our configuration file. And this is our base pattern. So if we run that, keep in mind, you want your packages to be of higher priority to the packages that are in the Tumbleweed code stream. So if you were to overwrite, for example, Sway, with a newer Sway version, or something else, you pull that in instead of the Tumbleweed upstream. And the base URL, you see that in this slide, is your home. When you first do this, make sure to get to that URL first, because I have known about it, and it was quite hard to find it first, to be fair. After that, we can spawn a VM, and we can even see there's Kausei in here, which is generally very nice. So, I guess it's a success. Not really. We're not completely done. We need to do something with butterfs and snapper to make it a full micro-OSI, but that's too much for a talk. Generally, some tricks and tricks, if you attempt it, because I really want there to be more desktops in top of micro-OS. I want Budgie desktop. I want Sway desktop, which I'm working on right now. Cosmic is there as well. Like, we have so many cool desktops, and only see really one or two maintained on top of micro-OS. So look at what other people are doing, especially Aeon with Richard Brown. He does a fantastic job. I guess he works on it like basically full time at this point. Like, he puts a lot of hours into it. And look at what they are doing, because hey, documentation is hard to read, and if you're just getting started, which I was, it's hard. So don't be shy to ask people for guidance. Get into conversations with people, meet people. They probably have knowledge you don't, so just don't be shy about it. And Zipper can actually do quite a lot. You can look for packages. You can even look what requires a certain package, like backwards dependency search, which is great. I just put those here so you can like see them and have a quick reference. And man pages are always great. So here, a short outlook and reflection. I'm not really a fan of Kiwi yet. But mkosi can really do as much as I wanted to do. So hey, please just use Kiwi. Don't get yourself into the same pain that I was in. Mkosi is still my main go-to for creating container images. It's great for that, and I think it's what it really was designed for. And the systemd tooling is very nice for the most part, like systemd report or temp files. but at some points it's lacking something which is, gets addressed nowadays. In the future, I want to finish my project Tourmaline OS. Tourmaline OS is basically a base for Wayland compositors, which ships Sway by default. But I actually am glancing to create another variant of it. Like, I want to have a declarative solution for it, similar to to how you describe things in Nix. You create a Nix file, and then you put all your packages in it there you want. But I really cannot. Nix is not for me, like not at all. I don't like the language, so I just make up my own system behind it. And I don't want 1,000 different libraries on my system. So I just want the traditional Archer SUSE packaging with upstream repositories, put that into a file, say what I want to have installed, and then use something like systemd sysupdate to pull in those new partitions and basically have a declarative OS, if that all works out, what I imagine. Other than that, I said that I'm not particularly happy with mkosi. Maybe I'm going to write my own packaging. Maybe I'm going to contribute to mkosi. We'll see about that. And yeah, I have a bunch of personal projects which I really want to finish. I want to write a Wayland compositor, actually work on stacking Wayland compositor, being like floating windows. Super interested in sandboxing at the moment. And I finally want to contribute more things to the project of my friend Kiesel, which is a JS engine. And he's like putting a lot of work in there. And I just love programming languages. Yeah. So to finish it all up, arigato. I don't know how to pronounce the last thing, so arigato. And if you want to learn more, there are my talks. I put them online right after this talk. And also, this is the OBS link to Tourmaline OS. I really could use your help. If you are down to it, it's a lot of work. And hey, you can influence a lot. So yeah, that's it.